Hi guys, this is Adam Gussow from Satan and Adam, and today I'm going to give you a complete 10-minute lesson on everything you've always wanted to know about the blue third. I'm going to use a C harp. I'm going to play cross harp. That's all I'm going to do. I'm not going to mess around with other harps. And I'm going to talk about the blue third. Now, I've talked about this in various lessons. I use the term a lot. And I've had several people write to me and say, you know, what is this blue third? I thought that I'd explained it fully, but I guess I haven't, so I'm going to explain it fully now. And you will, the information that I'm going to communicate is not information you're going to find in any other harmonica instructional method. It's more precise than any other teacher is going to give you. And it's the real deal. I learned from a guy who knew how to hit this note. He showed me who to go to listen to get it. And this is, let's talk about this. Let's talk about the blue third. Well, before we can worry about the blue third, we need to worry about what a third is. Okay? You have your harmonica and we're playing cross harp. If I go two draw, that's my root. These are chord tones. That's my root. The three hole draw, if I play it straight with no bend at all, kind of blue skies, open air, wonderful. That's my major third. Four hole draw is my fifth. A lot of songs, you know, for beginning trumpet players like taps. Reveille. That's your major third. We haven't gotten to the blue third yet, but you need to know what the unblue or major third is. If you want to remember what the major third sounds like, think about the Star Spangled Banner. Oh, say can you see? Okay, I'm going fifth, third, root, third, fifth, octave. I'm not a singer, but you know, you get the idea. Oh, say fifth, third, root. And if I hit that third the right way. Okay, so what's the blue third? What's that blue third, Adam? Okay, when blues players, whether it be guitar, whether it be harmonica, whether it be blues singers, when they do the third in blues, they flatten it slightly. Now, the standard way that this is notated, actually W.C. Handy in Memphis Blues was one of the very first people to notate this. What he did was he notated it as a minor third. The minor third is one half step down from that Star Spangled Banner third. As, you know, Jimi Hendrix messes with it. It's very minor. We've associated it with sadness. Think about taps. Not taps, what's that? The funeral dirge. Think about, so it's the second note of the funeral dirge. Is your minor third. Most players, most harmonic instructional methods will tell you that that's the blue note. Tell you is that in fact it's not the blue note. The blue third is not one half step down from the major third. You know why? Because if you watch a blues guitar player play blues, they'll put their finger on the minor third, and then in every case they'll smear it up a little bit. So why? So they're not getting exactly the minor third. They're getting the minor third smeared up a little bit. What is that note? Well, one way of thinking about it is that it's a note that's not on the piano. W.C. Handy tried to notate it. It's if you subdivide the area between that minor third and the major third, the Star Spangled Banner third, and cut it in half, you get what's called a quarter tone. So one way of understanding the blue third would be to say, well, or the blue third you're going to use most of the time would be to say it's actually that quarter tone between minor and major. The reason I like that is because the emotional subtext of blues, the emotional register of blues, is actually a tension between minor and major. It's everywhere in the lyrics. I'm laughing just to keep from crying. I'm major just to keep from being minor. What blues does is find a place where major and minor, right, laughter and sadness, tragedy and comedy, despair and euphoria, where they're kind of locked together, and should I stay or should I go? Little Charlie and the Nightcats. I hate to see you go, baby, but I love to watch you walk away because you got a nice caboose. Okay, so that's blue. And if you think about blues and think about those things being intention, you understand why the blue third is a tricky note to get, because it's not the major third. Your major, if you're all happy and sunny and you belong to the nicest sorority on campus and everything is going your way, and you know, that's not the blues. That's not the blues, right? The blues is that laughing to keep from crying that some of us know. Okay, so how do you make that note? You know, you can start off by simply trying to shave it down a little bit, but the best way of doing the blue third, I think, is to really listen to players who know how to do it. The record that I would suggest you get is Big Walter Horton with Carrie Bell, and listen to Have a Good Time. Some players will put a little bit of vibrato on it. Really good harp players can actually, a little bit like a pitcher who has motion, you know, pitchers who pitch fastballs who are really good, you hear the commentators saying that fastball has a lot of action on it. Well, how can that be if it's just a fastball? There's no, because they're spinning it slightly. The best harp players, when they do that blue third, they begin with it closer to the minor third and they release it a few degrees in the course of playing it. Do you believe that? I'm telling you the truth. Try that. Try going from minor to major in the course of one quarter note. Adam, do you mean to say that's blues harmonica is not just about... What? You mean all of that's in there? Well, Big Walter Horton was not giving a lecture like this, but let me tell you something. He was doing the things I'm telling you are there to be done. Because I spent years saying, how can this stuff sound so good? And I broke it down. So there's the machine language of the harp, which is the rhythmic machine language. But there's also the subtleties of blues tonality. So you've got that blue third. The way I like to teach it is to say, do the song Spoonful. That spoon, that spoon, that spoonful. Now there are many ways, I'm going to have to do a second lesson I can see on the blue third. It's very hard for many players, let's back off. How do you even make this note? How do you put that kind of a bend on the three-hole draw? For many, you know, advanced beginners to early intermediate who are working on this, intermediate players, that kind of subtlety, how do you do it? Oh, little cricket. Cannot be explained. No, I'm going to try to explain it, but when I do it, I have my mouth, my jaw in various positions. I've had a... So here's one way. Take the major third, three-hole draw, no bend. You got to get a good, strong single note. You can't do the blue third unless you're doing that. And I want you to hit your tongue on the roof of your mouth and hit that three-hole draw repeatedly. Now, if you were going to bend, what would you do? In my case, I pull my tongue up and back and down. How can I do all three? Well, kind of, you're pulling the lower end of your tongue kind of down in, but that means you're pulling the top part kind of up really close to the roof of your mouth, like you do with any bend, okay? But I want you to do that while you're tonguing the note. While your tongue is tapping on the roof of your mouth, I want you to begin to apply bending energy. That that's an easy way for many people to start to get a blue third, because you can just slowly apply the energy as you're tonguing it. And then once you do that, I want you to try to go back and forth between that note that you're starting to tongue and the two-hole draw. And just release and hit the two draw. We're through with this lesson, but I'm coming right back.